Hey everybody, what's going on? In today's video, we're covering earnings season, which begins right now. So we'll be looking at which companies to watch. We'll look at some important macro econ data this week, like PPI, the Producer Price Index, and retail sales. Why we need to think and invest globally. There's a lot going on around the world, and we need to pay attention. Will the rally continue, or is it doomed? We'll look at the market and see where it's going to go. We'll look at last week's setups and see where they ended up and if we made any money or not. And we'll look at some new setups as well, specifically Verizon and Hims, which are looking really juicy. So make sure you watch until that point in the video. By the way, make sure you smash that like button. We put a lot of work into these videos, so it really helps. And if you're wondering who I am, I'm Kevin D. And I've been trading for 25 years. I'm a full-time trader and working through the second level of the Certified Market Technician program. If you're wondering why I do this, I work in the investor community. I run it and do these videos every single weekend to help keep our members up to date on what's going on in the markets and highlight fresh opportunities. It's a really cool community of like-minded traders. So if you want to check it out, I put a link down below in the description. Let's get into a quick disclaimer really quick here. Everything we do here is for educational purposes only. We are not investment advisors, do not provide investment advice. All trading investment decisions are your own and done at your own risk. All right, let's do this. So what we got coming up in the earnings calendar? Okay, so you can see tomorrow morning, Tuesday morning, we've got Morgan Stanley, some more really big banks, and Goldman Sachs coming up, and a bunch of second-tier banks as well. We've got second-tier banks all week long. But the big guys, Morgan Stanley, Goldman Sachs. We're going to take a look at some of the other banks that reported on Friday. We'll take a look at those real quick in a few minutes. So you probably want to pay attention to these guys. So that's tomorrow morning. Tuesday after the close. The big one is United Airlines. We already had Delta last week on, I think it was Friday. And we've got United today, or sorry, Tuesday after the close. Before the open on Wednesday, another big bank brokerage, Charles Schwab. On Wednesday after the close, we've got Alcoa, probably the largest aluminum company in the world. There's a lot going on in base metals. So this should be really interesting with Alcoa reporting. On Thursday before the open, we've got Procter & Gamble. Some other interesting companies down in here as well. Maybe Fastenal, an industrial supplier. Another one I think is going to be really interesting is TAL. It's a Chinese education company, and these have been coming back to life, so it'll be interesting to see what happens here. I think Edu might be reporting sometime on Thursday as well. Then Thursday after the close, this is the thing I think the biggest of the week is Netflix. We always look at Netflix every weekend, and today will be no exception. For the last year or so, Netflix has always had really big moves on earnings. So we'll be taking a look at that and watching very closely on Thursday after the close. And then on Friday before the open, we've got Schlumberger, a oil services company. So that should be fairly interesting as well, because, all of these companies have their stocks have been doing great for the last year or so. That is it for earnings. Let's take a look at our macro this week. So Monday, today, when I'm recording this, markets are closed in celebration of Martin Luther King Jr.'s birthday. I wish he was here with us to celebrate it, but we can think he was a great man, and we can have him in our thoughts today. Tuesday, we have the Empire State Manufacturing Index. I don't know if people are going to pay much attention to this or not. Maybe. It can move markets, though. And we've got lots of Fed starting on Tuesday, starting tomorrow. We've got lots of Fed speak all week long. You know how these guys love to talk? And I think they love to see the market move when they talk, because they always seem to try and say things that move the market. On Wednesday, we have the producer price index. That's an important number. That is, similar to the CPI, the consumer price index. This producer price index, these are the input commodities and everything into all the things that we as consumers buy. Speaking of things that we as consumer buys, we have retail sales on Wednesday as well. All right, on Thursday we've got housing starts. This is a fairly important number, and also building permits. So we get to see, the health of the construction industry, and specifically with regards to housing. I think with mortgage rates as high as they've been, the housing market has been pretty, or not, maybe not the housing market, sorry, but the home builders have been doing really well, surprisingly well. I kind of don't get it. So I've kind of stayed away, but you can't help noticing that those home builders are good looking stocks. Also on Thursday, as always, we have unemployment claims. And on Friday, we have existing home sales. So you can see there's a lot going on in the home building market. All right, it's time to take a look at the time to take a look at the markets. We're going to start this week, do something a little bit different. We are going to look at international markets. Because these have been moving nicely and they've been outperforming US markets. And I really think it's time, we probably should have done this sooner. I have been investing a little bit in international markets. I wish I had invested more, and I'm looking for places to get in. So I think this is something that we're going to look at more and more as time goes on. Because these international markets have underperformed the S&P 500 and the US markets for so long, and they are now outperforming. And it looks like, they could see a long period of outperformance over US markets. So we've got to have some of that in our portfolios. We need to participate in that. And we'll do a kind of a big overview today, and hopefully I'm able to convince you why you need to be looking at these markets. And then we'll get into more detail as the weeks move forward here. So let's start there by looking at, and I want to show you my relative strength charts. I know a lot of you have seen these before. So in the top pane here, we are looking at, actually, we want to look at EFA. EFA is the ETF that is Europe, Australia, and or Australasia, and developed countries in the Far East. So think companies or countries like Japan, Taiwan, those kind of countries from Asia are in this ETF. They've got to be developed countries. China's not in here. We'll get to China in a sec, though. So this ETF, as you can see, has been in a down, you're mostly in a downtrend until around October, right? This chart goes back to early November. But you can see around October, it started to move up. And it started to do it, I think, kind of, a little bit before, or maybe better than the S&P 500 did. Now, in the bottom pane of this page, we compare EFA to the SPY, the S&P 500. And when this chart is going up, that means EFA is outperforming the S&P 500. And you can see here that, this relationship was in a downtrend, and that downtrend really ended, in August. It flattened out, but since November, look how strong EFA has been compared to SPY. This is a place that we should have been getting into in November. And we may not be too late. So this is somewhere we want to look for an opportunity. And I'm highlighting these ETFs, these big ETFs, because it's a really easy way if you don't know anything about international markets or want to buy stocks on international exchanges. It's a really easy way to get involved in these markets, to get some exposure in your portfolio. Okay, so that's Europe, Australasia, and the Far East. Let's take a look at emerging markets. So EEM is the ETF we usually use to look at emerging markets. And you can see here again, long-term downtrend. In fact, if we go, I mean, if we go way, way back in time on this, you can see, these have pretty much done nothing forever, right? But over the last year or so, or a little, just a little over a year, oops. Sorry, I'm just trying to, I need to line up these charts here so that they make sense. There we go. Okay. You can see much like EFI, EEM has, been in a decline, and then that decline kind of flattened out around October, November, and then started to move up. And you can see that its relationship to the SPY, it has been outperforming the SPY since the end of November, and outperforming quite nicely. And remember, these are emerging markets. These are, developing countries around the world. These are not the countries that you normally think of as, being the big industrial nations, the countries that you think are, leading the world economy. But they are certainly leading the SPY and outperforming the SPY. Now, a lot of this has to do with China. So let's just take a look to get sort of China out of the equation, because China plays a big part in this EEM ETF. Okay, so we can take a look at this relationship without China. We can look at EMXC. So this is emerging markets ex China. EMXC. Yes, that's right. So yeah, our top painting here is EMXC, and you can see that, compared to some of the others, it's not doing as well, but it is still outperforming the S&P 500. This relationship is moving up. That means the EMXC is outperforming the S&P 500. But at the moment, this is not something I'm, really terribly thrilled about. It's not outperforming that much. I think there's better places we can be, as you've seen. Now, if we want to specialize a little bit, one of the places that are, or one of the ETFs that I went into in early August was Turkey, of all places. My timing on that was really good, thankfully. That is up right now, even after this pullback. I'm up 55% in that position. Was up as much as 75% up in here, and I started to peel some off as soon as it started to roll over. I thought, I'm up so much in this, and I took some off of it. I still have a pretty big position here. I thought, I mean, I want to wait and see what happens around this 50-day moving average, and you can see that it is, the decline is holding for now. But I've been very happy with the way Turkey has outperformed all of my portfolio, basically. And look here, look at the way it has outperformed the S&P 500 since the beginning of August. This is just amazing. Another one worth keeping an eye on is Mexico. Mexico, for a lot of us, I think, or maybe it's just because I'm Canadian, Mexico is a country that I love. Mexico, I love vacationing there, especially the west coast of Mexico. I really enjoy myself there, and I love the Mexican people. But for, I think for Canadians, and maybe for a lot of Americans, it's, we don't think of Mexico as a really, strong economy, something is that is going to lead markets. But sure enough, when we compare this to the S&P 500, what do we see? We see that Mexico has been outperforming the S&P 500 for quite some time. Basically, it's been outperforming since December of last year. So how many of you are surprised? Because, when I pulled up this, even though I bought into the EWW in late October or November, added some of this ETF into my portfolio. Today, preparing this was the first time I looked at this relationship chart, and I was really kind of surprised by how much it's actually been outperforming the S&P 500. Now, I mean, over that period of time, you can see a lot of chopping around, a lot of sideways price action in this, during that time period. But nonetheless, Even just going sideways over the last year is doing better than the S&P 500, which was going down and is now going sideways. So, pretty interesting stuff here, I think you have to agree. So there's some ETFs for you to look at. Start thinking about this and start thinking about ways that you can get involved internationally. All right, so let's move on to the S&P 500 itself. Now you can see that we are still firmly in a downtrend here. I've heard so much talk about how the bear market is over. The new bull market has just started. People are saying this as if it's a done deal. And you know, if I mean, you know me, I'm pretty bullish on the market, but I'm a realist as well. I can be optimistic and a realist and say, no, we are still in a bear market. Look at it. We are in a downtrend here, and we have not broken through this downtrend yet. Yes, recent price action looks really good. I like what I'm seeing here. We are making higher lows, but we are not yet making higher highs. So we've got work to do. And I'm not gonna start even considering that we are in a new bull market until we break above these two highs here, let alone breaking through this trend line. That's not enough for me. We've got some major resistance overhead, and we've got these two highs here. In fact, I should mark those in as a pivot level because it's an important pivot level. There we go. Once we're through 410, then I'll start entertaining the thought that yeah, maybe this is a new bull market. We're setting up like it's a new bull market. We're setting up like the bottom is in, and I do really think that the bottom is in. But I think we got a lot of sideways to go here. I don't know if we're going much through this 410 area. I think we've got many months of sideways. We are not blasting up into new all-time highs anytime soon, in my opinion. But like I said, though, we've seen some positive price action. We've had a really nice run in the really, really nice run in the last 6 days, and we've closed above the 200-day moving average for one of the few times, over the last year. So things are looking good. We've come out of a really nice base here, and this whole thing is looking like a nice basing pattern. But like I said, lots of work to do. All right, let's look at the Qs. Speaking of work to do. So this is the NASDAQ 100. These are our big tech stocks, our large cap tech. And you can see that this is still looking really kind of, maybe not so weak right now, but certainly, not healthy. It's not looking like there's a whole lot of strength here. Yes, we've had a really nice move over the last few days, but look at, we're coming into this gap here. That's going to act as resistance. We have closed right on the 100-day moving average. We've got a big downtrend line overhead still. We've got a numerous resistance levels overhead. The 200-day moving average is overhead. So, don't let anybody fool you here. There is an awful lot of work to do here, and it's mostly in those FANG stocks, as we'll see in a bit. Let's look at IWM, the Russell 2000. This is an index definitely showing a lot of strength. Like what I'm seeing here, just like the S&P 500, like this base, like this higher base than this base and this base. Really like that we're coming and attacking, these highs right here. You can see we're a lot closer to these two highs than we were in the S&P 500. It's still got, it's got a bit of a ways to go before it gets to those highs. But IWM is almost there. We're definitely seeing some outperformance from this index. However, we are coming into a strong resistance level after having made a big move. This is a big run. I think we need to consolidate in here a little bit. I'd love to see this consolidate a little bit before breaking out higher. That would be very healthy. If we go up and break out through here, and then maybe hit this level and turn around. If we do that without, consolidating first, if we go up into here and then stall and start coming back down, I think it's going to come down quickly. But if we consolidate, that builds us a, you know, a base, lets everybody rest a little bit, lets some people who want to take profits, lets those weak hands out of the stocks in this ETF, and then we can go higher and have a really good chance of getting through this first resistance level quite easily, and then maybe going and attacking this gap area. If we go sideways in here over the next few days, don't complain. It's a healthy thing to do. All right, let's take a look at our volatility index. This little tiny candle here is today. Futures markets are open, some commodities futures markets are open, and the VIX futures markets is open. So we are seeing movement in this index today. But wow, look at this breakdown out of this triangle. Really broke down here, and continued on Friday to break down out of there. And look where we got to. We haven't seen levels this low since basically exactly a year ago. This is really bullish. This is really good to see. All right, let's move on to the 10-year yield. After breaking out of this little basing pattern, came up here and stalled out nicely, moved back down. It's come right back into that basing pattern. It looks like over the last couple of days anyway, the bottom of this base is now acting as support. Of course, we want to see the 10-year yield coming down. 10-year yield coming down means that equities are going to be going up. Let's look at the dollar index. That has been behaving fairly nicely as well. You can see that it started to form a base, and over the last week and a half or so has broken out of that base and broken out of this long-term trend line. I want to show you, where this trend line started, which was way back here in May of 2021, and we've now broken out of that. But to keep things in context here, there we go. We are coming into what should probably be a fairly strong support area in here, all the way down to, let's call it, oh, 98, 99 on this. Nonetheless, though, really nice to see this pull back. And this is one of the reasons why we're seeing so much strength internationally and strength in commodities. So hopefully this continues to the downside. All right, let's take a look at, speaking of commodities, we will start with gold. So you can see that gold has had a really nice run since the beginning of November. We've been pointing this out. We've been pointing out the areas of major resistance, which is around 1800 here. Once it finally got through there, it consolidated, and it's been consolidating these gains until this very recent run-up. Now, we've come into another area of major resistance up around the 1920 level. I wouldn't be surprised if we see some more consolidation here. Maybe it moves up into this, 1960 to 65 area of resistance and consolidates up there. But some consolidation here over the next little bit. Would not be surprising and should be considered to be healthy. Let's take a look at the miners. So this is GDX, the gold miners. Very similar price action here, of course. A little bit stronger than gold, I would say, but coming into some resistance up in here. This gap that goes way back into last summer or last spring. Will be interesting to see what happens there, but quite often these miners will lead the commodity itself. Silver has still consolidating, but this is a really nice base that's built here. I'm expecting this to break out and do so any day now. Maybe even tomorrow. I think that silver is going to do some catching up to gold. Copper. So this is one of our base metals, one of the industrial metals. This has had a really nice run over the last week and a half. Surprisingly strong, really, over the last week and a half and the way it broke out of this nice base here. It's now forming another base. Nice little bull flag going on here. If you want to play in this space, watch this bull flag. Really easy, clean setup on this one. What else? Oh yeah, the Journal of Commodities Index. It's broken through this major resistance level. Nice to see it back above that level, but we've still got some resistance overhead. We've got that declining 50-day moving average, 100-day moving average, and 200-day moving average overhead. So definitely some work to do here. And most of that work, of course, all the heavy lifting in this ETF is done by crude oil, which we'll look at right now. Okay, you can see the crude oil has come into a resistance level. This is a pretty important level here at 80 to 85 zone. 80 to 82. You know what? Actually, let's draw this in a different way, because that really is a zone, and it's a really important level. So there to about there. Perfect. Okay. There's going to be strong resistance here, but once it breaks through here, it can move fairly quickly. I want you to note the price action over the last month or so. Okay. So, you know, coming off these lows, we came into here, into that 80 level, 80 to 82 level, built a base, built a nice base, you know, and this looked like it, you know, it could very well have gone higher. It probably should have gone higher, but it broke out the bottom of that base. And it did it really in 2 days, or, you know, really 1 day was the move out the bottom of the base, right? After it couldn't go through the top of the base, boom, in 2 days it was right down here. But it's been recovering ever since. At first I drew this in, and last weekend I would have been talking about this bear flag, because that's what it is, or that's what it was. There was a bear flag in here. Now, it's broken out at the top of that. And you know how we say, from failed moves comes fast moves, right? We didn't really move fast yet, but, and we're down today, because the oil futures market is open today. We were down a little bit today. However, we've got this, what was the top of this bear flag. If we extend that trend line now, that's been acting as support. So it'll be really interesting to see what happens with this tomorrow. The support hold and then it moves higher. And like I said, it could move really quickly through here. So pretty interesting. I think we're going to have a really interesting week in oil ahead of us. Natural gas is still consolidating these lows. The momentum on the downside has slowed right down. Wouldn't be surprised to see this slowly start to turn up again. XLE is our energy ETF, and you can see that is near highs, having built a nice base, but, you know, moving out of the base slowly, but doing it in a healthy way. XOP is our oil producers. And you can see that these have built a base, tried to break out the bottom of the base, and are now moving higher, but coming into some resistance. Let's draw that in here, make that a little more clear. Okay. Yeah, you can see where we've got some resistance there, and this would be XOP, the oil producers. And oil services index. This ETF has been doing really well, really strong in these oil services stocks. This is suggesting that the price of oil goes higher. These stocks are doing well because oil companies are drilling new holes in the ground. These oil services companies are getting a lot of work. They're really busy. And oil companies are drilling holes because they see profits ahead for themselves. All right, let's look at TAN, the solar ETF. You can see that this had a really nice recovery after that nasty move down. We are coming into resistance after a big move up. I would not be one bit surprised if we either stall and go sideways or we roll right back over again. This TAN ETF, solar stocks in general, are very volatile, as you can see. And, you know, they... often don't spend a lot of time going sideways. They will often make a move and then, you know, almost instantly reverse. So, but what we want to see is we want to see this go sideways. Let's consolidate a little bit and then break out of there. We don't want to see this go straight through this. First Solar, probably the best performer of all the solar ET or solar stocks, solar companies. And you can see this broke out to new all-time, or not all-time highs, but these are like decade highs. It hasn't been up in this level for at least 10 or 11 years. I think this is the one. Unless I'm mixing this up with another. Yeah, okay, here we go. Back here. This was, yeah, 2011. It was when it was near these highs. Okay, yeah, nice new highs here. Not a high momentum breakout, but you know, still just making the move higher and higher, and you know, not pulling back instantly. You know, like the last time it was up near these highs. All right, let's take a look at Canadian Solar, another one that's been doing really well lately. This has had a huge move for this stock anyway, you know, from under $30, from $28 up to $44 in about 2 weeks. You know, guess what? I'm gonna say this needs to consolidate in here. You know, even if it moved up here, I'd actually be okay with another couple of days, another little push up. But then it's got to consolidate in this area. And if it did consolidate in this area up in here, oops, that's not how I want to draw that. If it did consolidate in that area for say a week or two, I'd buy that breakout. I will be watching for that. Let's see, Enphase. Still underperforming, you know, coming off the lows, but you know, compared to these other solars that we've looked at, this is not where we want to be. I hope it does not have trouble with this 200-day moving average here. Really hope to see this move above this, but again, this is not what I want that I want to play in. I think there are better places to be. All right, let's look at consumer discretionaries. Really nice turn off the bottom here. You know, nice rounding bottom, nice space in there. There's going to be some resistance overhead. I think this can move a little bit more, probably up into this trend line in this 100-day moving average before it needs to rest a bit. So maybe a couple more updates there. Industrials. You know, these have been quite strong. They continue to be strong. We gotta watch out for this resistance level here. It's had some trouble here. You know, it had a little pullback on Thursday, but started to move back up into this on Friday. So it'll be interesting to see what happens here. I think a couple more sideways days in here would be healthy and then break out of that. Are you seeing a theme here? You know, markets and a lot of the stocks and ETFs within the market seem to be at a place where it would be very healthy if they just went sideways. Okay, financials. Financials are really interesting. I mean, look at this move. Look at this move on Friday. Now remember, earnings season kicked off on Friday before the open with the big banks, a lot of financial stocks. Specifically on Friday, we had, I believe it was JP Morgan, Wells Fargo, Citibank, you know, those kind of companies. All right, so you can see that there was a big gap down on Friday morning and then a really big move up, and it actually closed higher. It closed green on the day. Really surprising after a giant gap like that. So that gap was closed in one day. Really quite interesting price action. We're going to look at a couple of those names. JP Morgan. Same thing here. Look at this. Giant gap down right into the 21-day exponential moving average and immediately bounced up and closed up 2.5%. After gap down, I think it was gap down like 8% or something. I should probably actually measure that. Don't want to mislead anybody here on the size of that gap. Oh, okay, not 8%. Sorry. See, I was exaggerating. Went down, got down as far as, you know, almost 3.5%. That's a big move, you know, for JP Morgan. You can see, I mean, this is the biggest candle since, looks like their earnings here back in October. And looking at the whole, looking basically at all of the last year, this is the second biggest candle on this chart in over a year. So yeah, an important move, a move worth paying attention to. Let's take a look at that one intraday so you can see what this looks like. So look at here. Here we are in the pre-market, and what is this? This is 6:45 in the morning in New York when they released earnings. Boom. Just got slaughtered here, but bounced fairly quickly, started going sideways. This bounce here should have been a clue that hey, maybe this isn't a knockout punch. And then you can see as soon as we opened, tiniest little bit of volatility here right around the open, and then boom, it just goes up all day long. It maybe gave you this little pullback here to try and get in on this. But you had to be you have to have some guts and you have to be quick. But look at that move. Outstanding move here from JP Morgan. All right, let's take a look at Wells Fargo. Very similar kind of price action in Wells Fargo. And you can see that this one has been kind of weak, right? I mean, JP Morgan's a bit of a leader. We have been watching that on and off, but Wells Fargo been kind of weak. Look at the size of this candle here. What a move. All right, so that's our banks. And we've got more bank earnings coming on tomorrow. All right, let's look at technology. Technology, look at this, putting in higher lows. This is starting to, look a little better. The technology ETF is looking better to me, a lot better than QQQ. I like what I see here, but still a ton of work to do. Now, we have this original downtrend line that I'd put in here. You can see we've been broken through, so I mean, it's not a perfect trend line, but we got through that on Thursday. Now, I've drawn a new trend line over top here. It kind of mirrors what the 200-day moving average is doing. So as this moves up, you can see that we start getting into more and more resistance here. The higher we go, we've got this gap, the declining 200-day moving average trend lines, horizontal, resistance levels. There's a lot of overhead here for this ETF and this sector in general. There is some healthy price action here, especially with these higher lows. We really want to see this start making higher highs too. And you can see that there are hints of that going on here. But this next move, even if we consolidate sideways a little bit as we come into some of the resistance, this next move really needs to get above this pivot right here, above this resistance level. And then we can start saying, yeah, this is starting to look like an uptrend. All right, what's next up? Communication sector. This one's not looking bad, but again, some serious hardcore resistance overhead. We had a nice base, lower low is here, and we can confirm now because we have basically made higher high. So we can confirm this as a lower or as a higher low. The first step in an uptrend, in a new uptrend, so that's good to see. However, this is going to be some pretty strong resistance here. You can see we've got some trend lines overhead. We've got that 200-day moving average overhead. We've got gaps. Also, it's just like in the technology sector, right? There's a lot of overhead resistance, so we got to watch out for that. Let's take a look at Meta. We'll go into a bunch of our FANG Plus stocks. We've had some nice move, and of course, we've been following this move in Meta quite closely. Hopefully, some of you have been playing this move. We've closed that gap now, so I'm just going to delete that. We left a couple of gaps behind, but I'm not too worried about those because, contrary to popular belief, all gaps are not filled. We can move forward here over the long term without having to fill these gaps. So, nice base that we broke out of here about a week and a half ago, 2 weeks ago, I guess. I've moved up into what is now probably a fairly strong resistance level. This was the COVID low, from back in 2020. And it has acted as support and resistance in the more recent past, and it's now acting as resistance. I think we'll have no problem getting through here. This move up has been fairly well behaved, and I think this can continue to just grind higher. Maybe until we get up into this sort of 156 area, 156, 157 area, where the 200-day moving average is right now. I think then it's got to consolidate sideways for a bit, probably weeks, before then moving higher again. But nice, really nice move on this, and a little surprising. I mean, I got, I'm not a big fan of Meta anyway, but I was getting really bearish on this, and I'm pleasantly surprised to see this move off the bottom. It's a really healthy recovery. So congrats to anybody who's in that one. All right, let's take a look at Apple. Apple's still kind of weak. It stopped falling. That's nice. But where to now, right? It's moved up. It is kind of consolidating right under what is probably really strong resistance. Maybe this will prove. I mean, I think I fear that this is just going to turn and go down again. Maybe it gets back up through here. Maybe I'll be pleasantly surprised on this one too. But I don't know. Apple's just, it's too messy. Too messy right now. A lot of work to do, and it's just not a space I want to be. I think there are way better places to be than in Apple at the moment. Long term, of course. Over the very long term, yeah, I want to be in Apple. And I have ETFs that have Apple in it. And I have a large position in Berkshire Hathaway, who's got a very large position in Apple. So don't get me wrong, I'm not bearish on Apple. I just think I'm not that bullish in the short term. I think there's for me as a swing trader, there's way better places to be than this one. Amazon has had actually a really nice move off these lows, and it even got through what probably should have been a little bit of resistance there, minor resistance. Can this keep moving into what should be stronger resistance here, at this gap? I'm going to want to see this consolidate under that gap. That would be the healthiest price action, in my opinion. Netflix. Okay, so Netflix earnings, as I mentioned earlier, Netflix has earnings on Thursday. I think it was Thursday. I said that earlier in the video. So look at what Netflix has done, right? Really nice stair stepping up here. Just a continual series of higher lows and higher highs. Netflix is in an uptrend. Let's actually draw that uptrend. I think this uptrend is like maturing now, and we can actually sort of draw it in, with that right there. So you can see we accelerated away from the trend line a little bit. Let's draw in another one. Let's see which trend line wins. Okay, we've come now into resistance. Remember, this was the top of the gap before this gap back here. Top of the gap found some resistance there. It's moved back in there. It's lost momentum. Resistance again. Does it roll over from here, or does it continue higher? I think this has been a bit of a grind up into here. Either way, as long as it doesn't pull back hard, I think either is fine. Either you go sideways here a little bit and then move higher, or you just continue to grind higher. I think obviously it's an easier play if if this consolidates in here a little bit for a few days and then breaks out and moves higher. That gives you a nice low risk play. I think it's a higher risk right now to just buy this, hoping that it goes higher. But the direction up is definitely the direction I think this is going. It's definitely now in an uptrend. There is some resistance overhead, though. Got to be aware of this if you're going to get into this. Google. It's another one of these big names that I like, but I don't like it right now. It's just it's too close to the bottom. Just too much overhead resistance right now for me to want to play in this. I'll change my tune once we're back up in here and consolidating. If we get back into where this base was, consolidate, spend some time in there, then it'll be ready to go in my opinion. But I don't want to play it between here and here because I think there's too much risk that it just rolls over and goes down. You know, if the market rolls over, this is going to be one of the first stocks to roll over. All right, Microsoft. I think we're kind of the same sort of deal with Microsoft. Just sort of messy, lots of overhead. It's got a lot of work to do. I don't want to be there. Same goes for Tesla. You know, I'm pretty bearish on Tesla, and this is one that I think actually could roll over, and doesn't necessarily need the market to roll over for this one to roll over. I'm still kind of bearish on Tesla, but I know that bulls are looking at this consolidation here, and they're eyeing that up, and you know, they're thinking that this could be a really good play out of here. And I don't disagree. You know, in any other stock, I would say, yeah, I'd be very interested in playing a breakout out of that. But no, I think there's too much sentiment, negative sentiment, too much going against Tesla right now. And Elon, his was it stock manipulation trial starts this week. So that is a little bit of a red flag, and that, you know, who knows what's going to happen there, and that could easily affect Tesla. So, not a place I want to be right now. All right, semiconductors. You know, I mean, it's nice to see them move back up into, you know, getting back up into where this base was. Getting back up to near those highs, but you know, there's going to be some resistance there. Something like that. Let's see what happens when we get up there. You know, if it breaks through that nicely, then yeah, I'll be happier about semiconductors. But again, another this sector that there's just sort of a lot of overhead, a lot of work to be done in that sector. Healthcare. Yeah, healthcare is a sector that doesn't really seem to know what it wants to do. It had been doing so well, it pulled back. It drew this big bear flag, broke out the bottom of it, but didn't come down too far. Pretty much closed this gap and has started moving up over the last week, but can't seem to get back into above, you know, the bottom trend line of that bear flag. Lots of volatility going on here. It just looks so indecisive. I don't want to guess at which way this is going to go. Could go either, and I think it may very well be a big move when it does pick a direction. Biotech, on the other hand, has picked a direction, I think. It certainly broke out of this base. And you know, this base really, I mean, it goes way back here into September, right? You know, we are back at levels that we haven't seen since the middle of September. I like this move. I don't like Friday's candle so much, but I'd like the move out of this space. So hopefully you can shake off Friday's candle and continue higher and get up into this 95, 96 level and then maybe consolidate there. Put in a nice bull flag right up in there. Why don't we just draw what that would look like? What I'd like to see happen here is put in a bull flag here, nice and high and tight. Something like that. That would be a very playable kind of bull flag there for the breakout above that major resistance and a move higher into the next level up at about 107. So that's what I'd like to see happen with biotech. Our defensives, our REITs, staples, utilities, nothing going on there. They're basically, I don't even want to look at them. Let's move into stocks that we were looking at last week. And one of those is BSX, Boston Scientific. And I think this is a really nice little setup here. So notice how this has been, you know, consolidating sideways for quite some time, about a month now. On Wednesday, this totally broke out to the downside. Look at that nasty move down out of there. Got even below its 50-day moving average, but it went right back up again. Put in this beautiful hammer candle, followed it up on Thursday with a nice big green candle, and it did all of this with volume too, right? And then Friday it consolidated a little bit. I love that consolidated right there. on Friday, because coming into a long weekend after a move like that, you got to think if it had broken out, it probably would have failed. So this is good. It consolidated there, that's great. If it consolidates up in here, nice and tight for a couple more days, even better. But it might not. It might just go on Tuesday, tomorrow. It may break out of here. And I think if it does, it's going to move quickly. And I don't think it's going to have a lot of trouble getting through this. Sorry, that's just my system. My system thinks it's... the market's open, so it's giving me warnings as we close here. Or as we would close if the market was actually open today. Okay, so yeah, I think that this can get through this 48 level, you know, this all-time high here. So this is one to watch. I think this is a fairly easy play. You know what to do with this, right? You either buy the breakout, and right now if you buy the breakout, I think the stop kind of has to go... It gets a little bit wide. It should probably go below Thursday's candle, maybe even below base here. So stops a little wide still. That's kind of why I'd like to see this consolidate for a couple more days, because then we can put the stop under the consolidation or under that resistance level, under that 46 level, would be a much nicer stop. But that's what you've got on that one. So that was BSX. NVIDIA we were looking at last week, hopefully you got in this gapped up and just, you know, started to go. It's made a nice move. It made through its 200-day moving average, so that was a nice one to play on the breakout. You know, if you had some guts and chased that gap, it definitely paid off for you. Hopefully you're trailing a stop up underneath this. This looks like it will continue higher. Watch out for this pivot level here. Maybe, yeah, somewhere in this area here, from the 180 up to the 186, 87 area. Could be a little bit of resistance in there. I would definitely probably be taking, you know, a small piece off as it comes into 180. Okay, FXI. We've been watching China, of course. Lots going on in there. You know, this is stair-stepping up a little bit. It looks like we've got a little bit of a base-on-base action going on here. Let's, okay, good. Whoops. Yeah, nice little base-on-base. Whoops. Come on. Wow. This is my first day with the new charting platform. All right. No reason to think this won't move higher. KWEB is another one of the Chinese ETFs. This is the Chinese internet ETF that we've been watching. It has been building a nice base. I think that breaks out higher. In fact, I believe that Chinese markets were open today. China was up, so I think that we should expect these ETFs to gap higher tomorrow morning. So that is pretty much it for the stuff we were looking at last week. Let's get into our new setups. I want to start with uranium, not because I like it, but because I know that a lot of people are talking about it. It's made a nice move off these lows here. You know, you can draw a trend line on this. You can draw a big triangle. I know that some people have drawn a wedge in there. Let's, you know, just sort of back up for more context. You know, this had late 2021. This had a really nice move. And, you know, during this move, everybody was very bullish in uranium, you know. So this is the uranium ETF, but, you know, the uranium mineral itself was going to be moving up to $100 or more. And you know, all these wonderful things were going to happen. And then all of that, most of that, you know, failed to materialize. Because really, it was in this area where retail really started to get involved in this, right? The real money was made in that first move. And since then, it's just chop, chop, chop. And that's really all this has done. And in my opinion, this is just more chop. But I did want to show this because people have been talking about it. People have been getting very bullish on this again. And there is a bull flag there, without a doubt. I just think that there is so much overhead in this. I think that so many people got burned last time, and so many people have been burned so many times since. Every time this thing tries to go up, has a sudden move to the downside. So, if you are going to play the breakout of this bull flag, just be really careful and don't hold it. Respect your stops, trail your stops, because look how fast and how often this makes fast moves down. Yeah, it makes fast moves up too. You can definitely make moves to the upside. You have got to be nimble. You absolutely have to respect your stops. So there you go. There's my take on uranium. Obviously, I'm not going to be playing it. I may watch it. And if you're playing it, I hope I'm proved wrong. I hope that this just goes up and up and up without having any of these nasty pullbacks. But the past has shown that that's not going to be the case. All right, let's move on to something I like a little better, and that is Verizon. Jerry in the Discord pointed this out the other day. Was asking for opinions on it, and look at—I mean, how do you not like this bull flag? You've got to like that. Had a really nice move, nice bull flag. I've drawn out what a target on this. If this were to break out in the next couple of days, that target is up and around the 48.75 level. That is the basically the top of all these gaps. Okay, so let's take a closer look at these gaps. Because if we're going to be playing this, we got to be aware of these gaps. This first one at around $45, I think, is the most important one. We've also got that gap is now just above this declining 200-day moving average. So that's going to be a resistance area that we probably want to pay attention in here if we play this. I'm just probably going to take some off. This is basically my first target, in around 44. I'm going to take a little piece off, maybe a quarter or a third, as we come into there. If you get through that, then you've got the top of the gap to worry about, and then you've got another gap just above that. So that's another zone. This is a zone here where I think there could be trouble. Now, if we get above that, so if we get above 46, then I think we make a really quick move through that and into the target, and probably even higher up into, say, $50. So if we can get through this, we could have trouble at these levels, but once we're through 46, I think it's a fast move to 50. Although, this target area, the 48.75 area, is a place where you might want to pull another piece off. So that's how I'm looking at Verizon. Again, this is not investment advice. I'm just telling you how I would play this. You have to play, you have to figure out your own risk levels and your own risk tolerance, and trade this for yourself if you're so inclined. Okay, next one is Coty. This is a consumer staples stock. It looks really interesting to me. This looks a lot more interesting than staples themselves. Let's just back up for some context here. We've had a long sideways movement, and a bit of a step down, and now it seems to be stepping up again. It's really moving up. I mean, it's in a nice uptrend since beginning November, and more recently, a really nice move over the last 3 weeks, drawing a bull flag. It looks ready to go, but it'd be nice if this, went sideways a few more days, and maybe even if this really tightened up under here. I think would make a playable breakout. And I'm showing a lot of breakout plays here, because they've started working again. At least they've been working in the last couple of weeks. They could stop working, just as suddenly. So we want to be careful. We want to be paying attention to the market on these. But They're nice, easy plays, really nicely risk defined, right? I mean, you're going to buy this on the breakout here. Maybe you buy at the bottom of the flag even. You could try that. Buy down here at 9:30 if it comes back down to here. Otherwise, you buy on the breakout, say around 9:60, and your stop goes just below here, around 9:20. So you're only risking 40 cents on this one. Nice, easy little risk defined trade. And you could get a nice move. You could get you could easily get a $2 move out of this. So what else we got? Oh, HIMSS. So HIMSS is really interesting to me. It has been, and I think we could see really, really big move out of this. This, if we back up, since popping up here after its IPO, you can see we had accumulation, stage one. We had markup, stage two, and then we went into a long stage three decline. Okay, distribution. Now, we are in a stage one accumulation phase, in my opinion. I think smart money has been buying this. And you can see it's starting to step up a little bit. Now we haven't made any higher highs yet. And that's because the smart money's not letting it make higher highs. However, we have recently started making higher lows. And I think this breakout is going to have legs. Now, it's risky right now because we've already had a really nice move. What I'd really like to see is a move up, say, into this $8 resistance area, and then a pullback down to this 740 to 750 area, and then a move up. So let me draw what that would look like. So we continue to move higher, but we roll over and then we pull back here, we find support, and boom, away we go. I want to be a buyer right here. That's where I want to buy this. Now I might miss it, and that's okay. There'll be another setup here, but this right now is not a setup. It needs to consolidate or pull back or do something. You can't buy this after it's moved this much, this fast. But like I said, there could be a really big move. If when this breaks out of here, this could really start into a new uptrend that could last a really long time, and this could easily be a double. In a fairly short amount of time. So I want to be involved in this. So that's HIMSS. Last one is Zoetis. Zoetis? Not sure how to pronounce that. But the symbol on that is ZTS. You can see that we coming off a bottom, basing, and looking ready to break out of that base area. Watch out for the 200-day moving average overhead. I would really like to see this one consolidate for a couple of days as well before moving higher. But yeah, I like this. I like the look of this setup here, especially if we get a little more consolidation in it. All right, that's all the stocks we've got. So let's take a look at what we've got coming up next week. Here we go. All right, so these are all our sessions coming up next week. So on Wednesday, we are doing a day trading roundtable. The first one we did last month was a lot of fun. Everybody really enjoyed that. And we had lots of really good discussion, lots of member participation, which was really awesome. So I want to do it again. And hopefully you want to keep doing this. So basically what we do is we analyze your day trades. We look at intraday setups, and you may not be, if you're a swing trader, you may not want to be a day trader. You don't want to really trade intraday, but these day trading setups can really improve your swing trading. So this is going to be a really good educational session, whether you're a day trader, a swing trader, and even an investor, if you really want to tighten up your entries. Learn a little bit about day trading because we're looking at really nice intraday setups. So when you get, when you have, setups on multiple time frames, when you have a stock that is breaking out of a daily chart or a weekly chart, and we move down to an hourly chart and then into a 5-minute chart, and just look for the perfect entry. When we can get that good entry, We're winning immediately. And that feels so good. And it's so easy to manage a trade when it is winning right from the start. And that's what you get from really good tight entries. And that's what you get when your entries, when you're thinking like a day trader on your entries. So I think that's one of the reasons we have so much fun. Because it's really fun to look for these good entries. And I like looking at I think we all like looking at other people's trades as well, and people are really good about critiquing their own trades, which is great. So that's coming up on Wednesday. For members of the Discord, they get to be there live. We will post it a couple of days after. We'll post a recording on YouTube. But if you want to join us and participate in these live sessions, go check out the link down in the description below, and hope to see you in the Discord. So thanks everybody for watching. Don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. If you've made it this far, you guys are the real stars. Thanks for watching, and hope you've had a great long weekend.